Chapter 6. For 3 years Kapilya traveled over the land of Mainyu, i.e., the land of India, east and west and north and south, establishing the faithists wherever he found them, and he donated to them whatever lands laid waste, and not tilled, but he touched not any land whereon other people dwelt, and tilled the soil. And it came to pass, the servants in the provinces fled from their masters, and went, and dwelt in the places of Jeevai, to so great an extent, that the governors and sub-kings complained against Kapilya, and he was reported to Yokovrana, the king in chief, Kapilya's foster father. And the king sent a commission summoning his supposed son to the capital, to answer the charges against him. When Kapilya was before the royal council, and demanded by the king, why he had come, Kapilya said, The servant of the great king answereth, his words are bound words. Whatsoever cometh out of Kapilya's mouth, Kapilya holdeth as his. There be such, as maintain that man, whose tongue is moved by the spirits of the dead, is irresponsible for his words. Kapilya creepeth not through so small a hole. To be master of one's flesh, and desires, and passions and words, these are great gifts indeed. Kapilya professeth these. Therefore, Kapilya bindeth himself in every word. Know then, most royal council, servants to our great king, Yokovrana, Kapilya was summoned here by the king, to answer certain charges made by members of the royal council. These charges prefer that Kapilya hath founded certain colonies which have attracted away the servants of the sub-kings, and of the rich, and thereby sowed disobedience in the remainder. Kapilya is come to answer these charges. Hear ye, then, Kapilya's answer. Kapilya being heir to the throne besought the king for leave to travel, and the king said unto him, Whatsoever the soul observeth, that may be good for the united kingdoms, do thou. Said not the king this? Yokovrana said, Yea, my son. Thereupon Kapilya said, When Kapilya traveled near and far, for 9 years, his heart was sick because of the misery of the poor and the glory of the rich. He beheld many forests and many plains where no man dwelt, and he said to himself, Let the poor come hither, and live. Yet he called not any poor man. Was it, then, an evil for Kapilya to say this to himself? The king said, Surely not. Then Kapilya went on, after a long season of idleness, Kapilya went the second time, to travel, and when he came to the forests and plains, behold, the poor were gathered together, and yet more coming. So Kapilya went amongst them to show them, how to dwell together wisely. Was this an evil in Kapilya? The king said, Nay, of a truth it was good. Then Kapilya said, In a little while they discovered it was good for them to dwell together, and to help one another, and the news spread abroad, whereupon the servants of the governors, and the rich, ran away from them. Is it not just to say of the king and governors, and rich men, that they are driving their servants away from themselves, because of hardships which are greater than the hardships of the gods? The king said, A good proof. But why sayest thou, the gods? These people for the most part believe not in the gods. And many of them, I hear, are believers in the Great Spirit. Kapilya said, Thou sayest truly, O king. But that is their matter, and not Kapilya's. The king said, Thou art right, my son. But how sayest thou of education? Shall not the laws be maintained? Kapilya said, Art thou the king? Or merely the servant of the dead? Shall Kapilya call him father, who is only a servant to carry out the laws of the dead? If so, then hath Kapilya sinned against the law. But hear ye, who are of great learning. Do ye obey one law of the ancients, and not another? The law of the ancients was that with the death of the king all laws died, and whoso became king afterward must need make new laws of his own. The law against educating the faithless is a law of the ancients. Let Kapilya's accusers find which they will, For if they stand by the laws of the ancients, then, indeed, have we no laws, and no king nor sub-kings. If they repudiate the laws of the ancients, then Kapilya hath not sinned against any law. Yogavarana said, Thou art acquitted, Kapilya. The laws of the ancients cannot bind thy king, nor the king's kings. Touching these matters, then, the royal council shall make new laws. And since Kapilya hath not contravened any law, neither shall the new laws interrupt the orders of the state, as they now are. Because of Kapilya's presence in the royal chamber, the power of Jeevai and his angels was great in that house. After this manner, that followeth, were the speeches of the sub-kings and governors, to permit great learning. To the faithless is to overthrow Dios, and his reigning gods and lords, for by great learning will the faithless ultimately become members of the royal council, therefore, at all hazards, great learning must be prohibited. Great learning is inimical to good servitude. Jeevai said to Kapilya,
Be thou present when these laws are passed, for by this means my holy angels will rule over the royal council for the good of all men.
For 100 days the royal council discussed the matter, but the angels of heaven kept them divided as to opinion and belief, so that no law was passed by them. Now after they had thus wasted much time to no purpose, Kapilya asked permission to speak before the king and council, as to what was wisdom, in the government of the nations, and it was granted unto him. This that followeth is, then, the substance of Kapilya's speech.